The final series of the day, and two countries collide in Kazakhstan and Poland, of course, as we have PiLiPiLi going to be going up against Elazer to find out who takes our final spot here in bracket number two. I am joined on the desk, of course, by Maynard, Tasty, and Tosi C, and obviously, this is going to be one for the ages. You're not. There's no way that was funny. I don't know why.
It was.
No.
Yeah, it was. Trust me, it was good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Cool stuff.
You gotta mix it up.
Yeah. At this point, in like the 12th hour, it gets very strange when it comes to being mixed up. But anyway, what are we thinking about this game? What are we thinking about this series? PiLiPiLi going up against Elazer. Elazer, probably the big favorite. What would you say? Well, what do we think?
Yeah, but I mean, PiLiPiLi has taken down some really good players so far today. He took down Sort of, who's a great macro Zerg.
Yep.
I hear his mechanics are top-notch. Mm-hmm. So Laser's going to have to bust out his best play here tonight.
I think PiLiPiLi is good, but at times he's like his own worst enemy, like we saw in some of those games back there, where he's doing a great job. He's kicking a lot of ass, but if he overextends here, I think Laser's definitely somebody who's going to exploit that.
May not.
Elazer has been brought up by my good friend Euthermal as being the blind counter master.
Right.
So there's going to be some weird games in the series, but I feel like Elazer is just better. As much as I love PiLiPiLi, and I'd love to see the NA ladder hero do some damage here in Katowice, I feel like this is where it ends.
Is there any kind of strangeness that will come out, say, from Elazer's side, or is it just him looking to play his normal macro game? Or what do we think?
I think it's actually going to be a little bit strange from both players. I think that PiLiPiLi is going to throw in a bit of strangeness, and that Elazer is going to do the same back at him.
Other thoughts?
Yeah, you know, it should be a pretty bizarre series because I think both have a lot of aggressive tendencies, and when you have a couple aggressive builds face off against each other, you know, that's where you get the really weird, interesting games. It's like how well can you think on the fly when both of you are taking tons of damage or something like that.
My final question before we go to the game is, does fatigue really come into this? We have been here quite a long time. Likewise, so have the players.
Oh, I think fatigue absolutely comes into play. I mean, that is, I think, the big theme of this entire tournament is that
it's a marathon.
Have to be, it's a marathon.
Yeah.
You have to be good at all the matchups on all the maps against all the playstyles, or you are out. But certainly, these guys are going to be taxed. I mean, they've been grinding all day.
Yeah, indeed. Thank you very much, gentlemen. We'll be checking in with you at the very end of this series, of course, as we now head over to the casting squad to figure out who is going to be our final member from bracket number two.
Thank you very much, James and the guys. We are very excited for the last best of three of a very long StarCraft day here out of Poland. Thought we stepped into the studio around 8:30. It's, well, 8:30 again, just 12 hours late. But it was fun. I really enjoyed today, man. I really love the way that we switched the broadcast up a little bit. Apollo has been here for 5 weeks. He's been working on it. But I'm proud of Sean. I think we should always send him 5 weeks in advance to any tour.
Yeah, I mean, he's really accustomed here to this new country. Already got a new family here in Poland.
He has permanent residency. Well, once again, rumor has it that he has adopted a dog as well because he was a little lonely over the last few weeks. Great guy, Sean. Gotta love him. I'm excited for this series. Should be really fun. What are we expecting, Todd? Well, at least I'm expecting adepts, more adepts, and a couple Stargate units. As we are loading in to Abyssal Reef, we're looking at the main base of our Polish are spawning on the left-up side of the map. Can he make it to the main event? It is Elazer.
Had a hell of a year last year, looking to continue here in 2017. And his opponents, playing as the blue Protoss, it's of course Darth PiLi.
You saw what he just tweeted? He's like, I already became a meme. Let's hope I can advance as well. Let's Those pictures are great, actually. Those pictures are really cool. Did you see the pictures that Artem just tweeted? They're so cool.
No.
Artem, one of the Blizzard 2, StarCraft 2 esports people here on Team of Blizzard. Really fun pictures. First, just the Darth PiLi picture, and then like, good, let the hate flow through. those pictures were really awesome.
Poor Deji, though, if he sees this, because the hate's definitely flowing through him after some of these games, I think.
See, Laser opening up very safely here, going pool before the hatch.
What do you think about Peak's mention of carriers here? How likely are we?
Oh, I think it's likely we'll see carriers, but I'm expecting carriers on a map like Proxima or maybe in a large map on a ground on Abyssal Reef. I think it's a little hard to get carriers out. It's not impossible, but I'm expecting more, maybe a couple Stargate units and just a crazy amount of adepts. I mean,
only if your name is Haz and you open with 30 Oracles.
Yeah, no, that's possible. I mean, PiLi is a pretty crazy player as well. Not Haz crazy, because, you know, who truly is, other than maybe Nice, you know, you know, the other Taiwanese.
He was
pretty crazy.
They all are.
Yeah. I loved that interview during Nationwide. We're like, you're sending out Nice? Yeah. Why? Because Haz is too predictable. Everybody knows he cheeses. They send out Nice, he cheeses too. It's like,
sickest man game.
I loved it. Taiwanese Protoss, man, all the way.
All right, PiLiPiLi here going for Zealots. We'll see if he ends up canceling that. Stargates, obviously, always the likely choice. A lot of the time against Zerg, even though we've seen our fair share of Twilight Council and Resonating Glaives already so far in this tournament.
Yep, one happy little Zergling is going to make his way across the map.
How do you like this wall? On Protoss?
Let me take another look at it. Oh, Overlord Speed already being researched. I'd love to see some Link Drop or Link Bane Drop. I really think it's incredibly good.
What rating do you get this wall?
Let's see how he continues building it. Right now, I guess he's just going to go for a full wall near the rocks, and then that's going to be the only entrance. If it's a double entrance, I don't like it. But, wow, he's going to go 3-gate. Okay. Maybe he's going to make some adept pressure without Resonating Glaive, something that Harstam likes to do, and then follow it up with an Oracle. And then later still at the Twilight Council. Those pushes are very weird because they hit just a little bit faster than Resonating Glaives does. And it's not supposed to work, but because it's not supposed to work, the Zergs are often not ready, and it actually does a lot of damage.
How happy are you, by the way, that Gillette sponsoring the Intel Extreme Masters?
How happy are you, Todd? I mean, I'm looking at that beard. I know times are rough in
esports. I didn't get any care package.
I know times are rough in esports.
I didn't get that extra work with the, what was it called?
We're not supposed to mention rival companies over here. Well, double Stargate being thrown down already. So then there is a good chance that we will see some carriers here.
Hmm.
But the Elazer has already spotted everything.
Yeah, usually when people do this, they open Resonating Glaives, right?
Yep.
And then go, say, like 7 adepts to 10, send them forwards. Force a lot of units on the ground, in which case it's even harder to get spawned and get ready for this target play. But in this case, it's spotted immediately, which is really nice to see for Elazer, because you can already kind of start to develop some sort of a plan. Like some Zergs, they see the double target on the way, they're like, you know what, let me just make a lair, a couple of Hydralisks, go and kill you.
You know, as silly as it sounds, I actually still think that dropping 8 links in a main would be very good, even against Stargate play, just because as a Protoss you don't expect it. And if the Phoenixes show up on the other side of the map, as we do see Phoenix production starting, plus one air weapons as well. Now that's my North American Protoss boy right there, Doss.
He's been watching your stream.
Or the pick daily, I heard Trap does it.
Oh, snap!
It hurt, he thought, it hurt.
Pig is not going to stand for this.
So we see PiLi.
It's like when I go and interview Stats, he's like, did you take that pill from Roddy? It's like, who's Roddy?
No, oh, he would never do that. I mean, he obviously is not.
Only one way to find out. I'm going to ask him tomorrow. Smix, get ready to translate.
A couple of Spore Crawlers being morphed in. It's an interesting build here by PiLi. Like you said, because he didn't add a Twilight Console, I must say, I'm surprised about this Nexus timing, Todd. It's 5 minutes sharp. Which I'm not going to say it's a late Nexus, but you can actually do it like 420 or even 430. And you can even do that with Resonating Glaives. Obviously, then the Phoenixes are going to be a little bit later. So the upside here is that the economic damage that the Phoenixes will do is going to kick in a tiny bit faster, but the Nexus is just a tiny bit later.
Okay, take me through this. Do you transition? Do you let's be honest here. You're the only guy that goes DTs from there, right?
On maps where I think it's possible to deny the fort. I don't think Abyssal is the best map ever to add a Dark Shrine. I don't think it's a terrible idea, but I really think that it's much more likely we're going to see a Fleet Beacon go down.
How does this do against Baneling drops potential, like we're seeing here?
I mean, the Baneling drops, that's something that obviously you can shut down, but just overwhelming amounts of Ling Bane, without a Dark Shrine, it can actually be pretty hard to defend, because all you have is 3 gateways, and 3 gateways is decent, but Zergs, like Elazer, they've got fantastic...
It's a shark!
They've got fantastic macro. Denying the fort here is very nice, by the way. That's kind of what you want to have. But I think it's hard, though. I really think that if Elazer produces overwhelming amounts of Zerglings and Banelings, it becomes really hard to eventually get a good economy.
Oh my god, it worked! There it is, the Fleet Bacon. Shout out to Nathanias. May's memes be with us at all times.
I wonder how many Stargates Pili is going to go up to eventually. I think once you start producing carriers, you definitely want to have three.
At least three, yeah.
Yeah, but even
with
then,
six gases.
Yeah, even then, halfway through, you're starting to float. And that's when I actually like to see him add a fourth as well, but I don't know if he does that.
I mean, it depends if you go for a mothership, because then you don't have the gas, right?
Are you a fan? Like, I don't know. So many of the big protosses are a fan of that quick mothership, so who am I to say that I don't think it's good? But me personally, I think it's too expensive, and it doesn't really add that much. But I know all the top protosses disagree. Yeah. So don't take my word for it.
I mean, they all do it, so
yeah, it must be
I
good
do it too. Then I lose.
First carrier is on the way, and we all know that Elazer is not the biggest fan of going up against the carrier. You see the fort being wiped in, so maybe a couple of cannons will be added later on to defend against the Lynx and Banes. And these Hydra Bane pushes are really hard to deal with, though.
Yeah.
Like, two carriers are not gonna cut it. Three carriers, then it comes down to cannons, Photon Overcharge, and your Adepts. If you get up to five or six carriers, that's where things become very nice for you as a Protoss.
So you reckon Elazer is going for that timing here,
yeah,
no matter what? He's making a ton of units.
Absolutely.
He started one drone. Like, I don't think we can quite safely say that he's going to droning up back again.
No, I think it's going to be a big Hydra Bane push. I think we're going to look at like roughly 20 to 24 Hydralisk by the time he makes his way to the other side of the map. Two Bane is going to try to wiggle their way into this mineral line. Good reaction time though by PiLi.
It worked!
Plus two is almost... Imagine if plus two is done, Todd.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hot.
Then it would work. Wouldn't it?
Yep. That would have been a lot of that probes as Funka or Kevin is showing us. No idea who's observing.
Okay, Graviton Catapult is on the way. That's very important to have the upgrade here, to have extra interceptors.
How many, just faster interceptors, right? Make sure they do a lot more damage. There we have it, 21 Hydralisk. I think these timings are incredibly hard to defend if you only have two or three carriers. The cannons, however, will help out. Seven
this
cannons.
This is the time where the Phoenixes fly on top of the Hydralisk army and it's like GG.
Yep, seven cannons start. More Banelings trying to make their way in, and this time plus two is not ready yet, but a lot of the pros were very low on HP. Good reaction time again, but will the cannons be enough? This is a terrifying Zerg army, Todd.
Yeah, a ton of Banelings being morphed here. He's going to force the couple overcharge and then pull back. Elazer regrouping. Doesn't really have any upgrades, actually, on the Hydralisk. He's just going to be the plus two melee that's going to hit right now.
If he takes care of the cannons, though, it's really going to be hard to fight these Hydras because the Adept count is low and there are no resonating glaives. I'm not sure. I don't think three carriers is enough. A lot of these interceptors have gone down. Plus two is not ready yet, and it seems like Elazer has hit the sweet spot.
Yeah, the Phoenix is coming, but a little bit late. One of these carriers is already down. Those two extra ones can survive.
Wow.
PiLiPiLi might be in a good position here. He deflects this attack, and then from there, we've got an Elazer who, like I said, is on plus two melee upgrades. No plus one missile. He starts that, but there's plus two attack upgrades here for all the air units of PiLiPiLi on the way already. And I mean, the carriers, they snowball out of control here from there as well.
Yep, 10 workers did go down, but that's not catastrophic. I mean, the main is going to be pretty much mined out anyway, so you can transfer a couple of workers from the main towards your third base. It's going to be hard for PiLi to take a fort, but you could almost say, hey, you've got plus two air weapons on the way. You're going to have five, six carriers soon. There's no rush for you to take a fort. And now, suddenly, I thought that attack was going to do more damage than it actually did. The Phoenixes really cleaned up those Hydras, and one or two cannons on the north side pushed out quite a bit of damage.
What's the Twilight Council for? Does he want to go into Storm, or is there a chance we see Resonating Glaives and then some sort of Adepts in the mix to fight on the ground?
I think on three bases it's hard to go into Storm, but perhaps he's going to do it. We'll see.
Or maybe take a fourth soon here. Elazer already starting to work on a fifth base. Went for the Infestation Pits.
Neural Parasite! That's cool.
Burrowed Infestors shooting Neural Parasites.
It's
basically saying, I hope you don't have a robo.
Misrelit Carrier, Todd. The Misrelit Carrier. That's an expensive little unit to lose.
Wouldn't it be sick if Elazer is like, oh, that's a hallucination somehow?
Yeah. PiLi realized, he's like, whoa, that's an expensive unit. As Nathanius would say, that's 400 minerals more, dude. More Bane is going to try to roll in, but the cannons are going to keep this mineral line safe. Well, the cannons will die, but the mineral line did stay safe. Resonating Glaze on the way, but Templar Archives also being wiped in. There we have that fourth Stargate, by the way. And I think Elazer is getting a little bit nervous. We know how much
Elazer dislikes
going up to Mass Carrier. Or going up against Mass Carrier, I'd say.
Was there a Robo Mate actually ever?
Nope.
Because Burrowed Infestors casting Neural Parasite on his carriers is actually a Protoss's nightmare.
Yep, he does have cannons, and he could obviously get an Oracle.
Oracle, okay. Yeah. But still, I mean, you have to land it.
But still. I mean, that's a lot of carry slot, and they've got plus two. I think plus two is such a crucial upgrade for these carriers. The damage, it just seems like it doubles once you get plus two. It's crazy. I mean, the upgrade tab looks rather simple, but this is still a very intimidating Protoss army. Do you think there's a chance that he tries to cast a Fungo or two on the Interceptors, or do you really think he just saves all of them with
Neural? Full Neural.
Yeah?
Okay. And then fly those inside of his army while he's killing the opponent's carriers. I mean, look at his amount of Hydralisk. With plus two missile, like, these are going to do a ton of damage. It's going to take a long time, actually, to hit that plus two missile. The Adepts on the ground are going to be very scary. I like that he brought the Mothership Pod because a recall might be forced.
Yeah, but he has no Observers here, so Neuro could be used. And there we go. Neuro is indeed casted. He should recall out as quickly as possible because otherwise you're going to lose a whole bunch of carriers here, PiLi. And losing carriers on three bases is very, very painful. Oh, God. This is not a good fight at all.
Recall was not used immediately behind this from PiLiPiLi, who's trying to fight.
Yeah, the Hydra count is actually kind of low, though. Not that many Hydras survive.
Oh, that carrier still on hit point. Wow. The Oracles comes in. Oh, he missed the reveal. He missed the revelation on those Infestors. But behind this, Elazer really doesn't have that much left over. Look at the supply already.
There is no anti-air left. Once again, the Hydra count is just not high enough. It really felt that was pretty much the best fight that Elazer could have hoped for. I thought that PiLi should have recalled out. He didn't. He stayed. And he actually got a great trade. Now there's a couple of Spores as well, but this carry count is quite high.
Yeah, I mean, these Infestors, they only have so much energy. The Queens being under assault here. And even though some Spores are shooting right now, it looks like PiLiPiLi is breaking through somehow. Void Ray a little bit confused about what he should attack.
The Hydra count is just not there, right? Even though a couple of these carriers are being neural, the Adepts are really reigning supreme on the ground because all the Banelings have disappeared. Okay, now finally a couple of Hydra show up, and that could perhaps be enough for Elazer to push this back as a couple of the carriers out of Interceptors as well. But the fourth base have died. I mean, PiLi has already done so much. Yeah. He doesn't have to stay here.
Now that was the fifth base. Yeah. He denied the fifth base, so he's on four bases himself. I feel like he should pull back here. Is he overcommitting? Because like
he doesn't have to do it, but he's doing very well so far. So perhaps we are wrong. Let's see. Can these Hydras clean up these Interceptors?
He's the fortress. Yeah,
the fortress going. That fungal dotot.
Yeah, Interceptor still cleaning up big time, and he's still trading against this Hydralisk.
Wow. I mean, four carriers did just go down there, but look at these couple of Adepts. They're doing so much work, and now all of these Hydras will fall again.
Oh, man.
Elazer drops below 100 supply, and that's never a good sign when three more carriers show up.
Every time you kill the Death Star, it comes back. It's the same with those carriers.
The fourth base taking a crazy amount of damage as well, and I think this hatch is going to fall. Meanwhile, PiLi is getting Storm. He's adding more carriers. What a run. What a performance so far by PiLiPiLi.
Yeah, Storm on the way. He's going to be able to get a bunch of Templar, high Templars here behind this, and a supply lead now for our Protoss player, who's going to be very happy to be on more bases, or equal amount of bases than the Zerg.
Felt like maybe he could have neuro the carrier there, but decided not to do it. I mean, this is just terrible for Elazer. He doesn't have the money he needs.
Yeah. Like, if you neuro from there, you would have used Revelation and then spotted all the Infestors.
I thought there was no energy on the Oracles. They were both very low. No, it's 41. Okay. 42. Now there is, but
pretty close. Anyway, fifth base being retaken now from PiLiPiLi and from Elazer, and PiLi will take his own fifth now quite easily. Walker counts 56 probes to 60 drones. Great position to be in as Protoss there.
Yep, and the Hydra count is just not intimidating enough. If you want to fight carriers with
income.
Hydras, that's 700-800 minerals more per minute. 19 Hydras is just not going to cut it once there are 7, 8, 9 carriers. And let's not forget, 6 High Templars with Storm now as well. Those Adepts, though, they somehow survived all the Banes, because actually Elazer had quite a few Banes, but a couple of Adepts survived, and the Adepts did so much damage on the ground.
I'm very worried for Elazer there. I feel like this is going to be one of those super one-sided fights potentially with Storms killing everything, kind of like we saw Harstim do earlier, but he has more potential here in this case with the Infestors that he has. Just landing Chain Fungal is going to be very hard. I'm surprised that we still don't have any Observers, by the way. Like, it's... I thought you were a gambler, but PiLiPiLi's next level. He's like, you know what? I'll just try and land the good end of Revelation here on these Infestors.
I mean, I think PiLi knows that he's super far ahead in this game at this point. If you're up in supply and you have carriers, something truly crazy has to happen for you to lose. Like the best Neurals, the best Fungos. Let's not forget about all these High Templars. Once again, the Revelation does miss the Infestors, but
Elazer
is on this, man.
He's going to need some. Oh, he's going to kill the High Templars with the carriers. That's actually pretty sick. A couple of storms do go down. But in the end, Revelation is casted. These infestors will fall. And I still don't think that the army of Elazer is big enough, as so many carriers survived. They've got plus two. There's a couple of adepts on the ground as well. All the Hydras are dead. GG. Look at Elazer's face. He's like, I can't believe that just happened.
If he didn't clump up all of his infestors there, he might actually have been able to win this fight, I think.
That was a sick move.
There was only the detection from Oracles.
Yeah.
Like, he had everything together, and then you can see from where the neural's being used. So clearly, there was going to be a revelation used there. That's probably what Elazer thought immediately.
Yeah, but other than the infestors, he really didn't have that much anymore. I felt it went wrong before. I thought the attack was pretty all right, you know, the one, the Hydra Bane attack he made. But PiLi getting all those cannons really saved the day. Without the cannons, I think there's no way he defends there.
I think the best thing actually that PiLi did in this attack was to wait for the longest time before using extra overcharges. Like, he used two in the start to buy himself some time, and then he was like, my front pylons are probably going to die to banelings, so I should wait until you use most of your banelings and then use the overcharge on the pylons that I've left over. That was a brilliant move.
Excellent observation indeed there. I totally agree. I think we've all been in a position where you're like, I've got 200 energy, let's go, and then, you know, your pylons die or they just run back and you're like, oh man, now I have no more photon overcharge. But yeah, you're right, he only dropped two, and then he dropped the photon overcharge on the northern pylon near that cannon, and that combo pushed out so much damage. And you need that time, because once you start dropping interceptors, the carrier damage output in that phase in the game, it's not that high. You only have plus one, you have two, three carriers at best. But that really saved the day, and after that, it kind of was PiLi's game to lose. Kind of thought he overcommitted at one point, where I was like, oh my god, is he throwing the game? But he stayed, he didn't recall.
That was a good timing. Maybe if he had waited, Elazer would have gotten a ton of spores, and it would not have been possible to attack him anymore.
Yeah, but especially without the robot, and maybe that game could have still been losable. But getting the kill on the fifth there, and once again resetting the entire Hydra count. Great play by PiLi. What a run so far. Imagine if PiLi qualifies for the group stage of the Intel Extreme Masters World Championship. That's a big surprise, Todd. I mean, I know what PiLi is capable of. He's often super high ranked on the North American ladder, you know, talking top one, top two, top three GM. He's done it all for a long time, but this was still a pretty damn tough bracket with a lot of top-notch European players.
I mean, he's facing a guy that made top four on this gun and up 1-0 and... Oh, there
he's
it is.
He's going to the dark side.
The hoodie went back on. Once it's over, Elazer, where are you?
Lights
reveal
off.
Reveal yourself.
Lights off, carriers on. Let's go.
Told you, man. Like, you take out the Death Star, a new one will come out. That was the same for these carriers. They kept on coming back with more and more.
That's a Size 7 gaming hoodie, right? What a cool hoodie. I don't know if they did it on purpose, but that's like the coolest hoodie.
It's like the hoodie you walk out to a boxing match with.
Yeah, when you train at night, when you run up the stairs in Philadelphia and you're like, Rocky, eat your heart out. I'm coming for you.
What is wrong with you?
I don't know. Todd, you as an MMA fanatic, you should have that ambition to at least once in your life run up and down the stairs in Philadelphia.
I like the training. I don't care about reproducing movies in real life.
Yeah, but that is training. You think running up and down the stairs is not training?
Yeah, it is.
How do you think Rocky became so strong, Todd?
It's a movie, mate.
No, it's not. It's a true story. You want to tell me that Drago Drago from Russia was not real? If he dies, he dies. That's totally real.
Ivan Drago is a fictional character, mate.
No. That was one of the greatest fighters to ever live on this planet, together with Rocky and Apollo Creed.
Mr. T as well?
No, that's a fake. Alrighty, we are loading into Cactus Valley for potentially the last game of the day, and that would be a huge upset. Can the Polish hope turn it around? Obviously, he would love to make an appearance in the main event. He's the top four finisher of BlizzCon last year. It's Elazer. And over here on the right top side of Cactus Valley, we're looking at the main base of our North American Protoss representing Sidestorm Gaming. It's PiLiPiLi. There's a lot of fun. Is that going to be your contribution to the intro, stuff? Breathing like Darth Vader.
That's the best I could do, man. Sorry. It's late. It's been a long day.
It has been a very long day indeed.
What do you make of the positions here?
I think with the double gate opening, PiLi is going to be quite happy. It would have been quite bad, I think, if the first Overlord would have spotted this immediately. But this is cool, not something you see super often. Every now and then, Neep still throws it in, and I remember Showtime doing it a couple of times, but that's already a while ago. He did it on Frost a few times. So I'm quite curious, like with the openings like this, I always feel as a Protoss, you put yourself in a position immediately where you say, I'm going to have to do some damage with my first two adepts, because if you don't do that, Todd, it's going to be pretty rough, because this is not an economic opening.
Elazer ideally needs to be able to spot this early, should be able to, with his second Overlord here that's headed towards this wall of.
What do you think PiLi is going to do? I don't think this is, with these positions, you want to go double Stargate again after three gates. I don't think this is the right position to do it. So maybe some Twilight play?
Well, if you play double Stargate, then you stop maybe at like eight Phoenixes and then do a transition instead of going carriers.
Yeah.
Maybe he likes the challenge.
I mean, it did work.
Well, it was different situation, right?
Yeah.
Like maybe like because of the map and like it would be tougher there. Like
different opening as well. One gate fast expand with the Zealot and stuff. Not a two gate opening over here. Let's see if these adepts will get something done for PiLi. If he's able to pick off like three drones here, that would be massive. Wow, very defensive shade there.
G Fuel. We are esports.
That's a interesting. Why would you open up with two adepts, Todd, and not even try to get a work kill? Maybe because he already.
I think it's like because it's so expected, maybe.
I guess. And he did force out eight lanes.
He's like,
so
the Overlord's going to see it, so I might as well stay at home, maybe try and surprise later. Gets the Twilight Council behind this. Who, after seeing two gateways like this, what Zerg is going to expect the Protoss to not necessarily be that aggressive and to follow this up with. Because usually, a lot of the time, people go into double Stargate behind this. So that could be the ultimate mind game if he was to go into a lot of adepts.
PiLi often likes to play macro game in game one and go balls to the wall and all in game number two. So there's a good chance that he's going to use the Stalker to deny the Overlord scouting. But Overlord speed is on the way.
And he laser overreacted already, by the way. Like, that was way too many links. He didn't need that many, I think.
He might drop a robotics facility and just go for a 7 or 8 gate. What do you think about that? Maybe.
Yeah. That would be very good.
I can see him do something.
Especially on this map, you can kind of hide that, like maybe it's in the back of your main base, but against Pneumatized Scarface, obviously it's going to be tough. That Stalker, though, maybe can get the Overlord snipe on this.
Yeah. But I feel the Stalker is already a tell, and now you see the Twilight being chrono boosted.
Yeah, there Robo starts.
Yep, there is that Robo. But there's still a chance that PiLi goes up to three bases, but I have the feeling with the Stalker that he. The Overlord lives. I have a feeling he wants to throw down four or five additional gates and just go for it. Go for an absolute crazy attack here and try to squeeze his way into the round of 24. Can you imagine PiLiPiLi going up against Bjorn and Innovation? Or Innovation, they're not in the same group. Could be Innovation and Dark and Showtime. We already had some sick clashes. You know, when people talk about the best games of 2016, Todd, they never mention Neep versus Showtime of Intel Extreme Masters Shanghai. You remember the game on Apotheosis? To me, that was one of the absolute best games of the year. I don't understand why nobody mentioned it. I love that game. It's crazy.
Yeah, it was good. You don't get this kind of high-level game, like such a scrappy game, going into like a base trade where they actually like end up expanding across the map. Like, very often, you don't get these games too often.
Such a unique, crazy game. And I love games which are just impossible to call, right? At the highest level, often one player gets a lead and he can kind of build up on it. And every now and then...
You just picture Whitera saying, GG, it's GG.
Yeah, it's GG, this game is over. And then every time you're like, it's not over yet. Whole bunch of adepts will be making their way across the map. They do have resonating glaives. PiLi is warping in a Nexus, so no crazy amount of gateways. Very defensive shade there once again.
It's a bluff!
How many banes do we have? He's gonna cancel the shade? No.
He's like, right now, I hope you made as many units as possible because I'm out of here.
You should have made at least 7 banes, and if you didn't, you have no idea what you're doing.
You would have died.
Yeah, because if I don't count 3
and
banes...
if he dies, he dies.
3 banes, actually not that many. I'd love to see a few more link drops, Todd. I think it's so incredibly good, especially against builds like this. The moment that the adepts warp in, like I'm not saying early game, right? I'm not saying with your first 8 links. I'm saying the moment that the Protoss wants to shade across the map, because that's often when you just warp in and you have no defensive warpings available. And it's so damn annoying. If you have an evil
thing. Adepts moving to the third base there. He's not ready. Elazer's just going to start on taking some damage at a time where we would like to be the one dropping banings across the map. This is bad.
Could have been a lot worse there because his bane count is really low. I actually think if he splits the adepts there, Todd, it's only 3 banes, 28 links. There's a lot of adepts, and there's still a War Prism around as well.
Meanwhile, even Walker count now. This is good for PiLiPiLi, who's going for 5 more gateways.
Yeah, I like that a lot.
The explosion de gate.
I think that makes perfect sense with how close the bases are towards each other. And
he's just going to try and kill him.
Yeah. I mean, but he can still macro up as well. He can also sit back. But maybe he's worried about just a stream of Zerg units making their way across the map. And he's like, if I go three gates and then go heavy into tech, I'm just not going to have enough Protoss to defend. So let's go up to eight gates and take the game from there. Ooh, Banes did connect with six probes there. 7-8. Wow, actually, Pili's not paying attention to this. I think he was too busy controlling his adepts on the other side of the map.
Yeah.
Losing 11 workers is actually a pretty damn big deal, because look at the work count. Suddenly, Elazer is still 10 workers ahead.
Yeah, maybe you should get a pylon like down there to be able to spot those units coming in. It's going to keep on happening as well. Like, once Zerg smells blood in the water like this, they will keep on doing this stuff.
Yep, and there we go. The pylons are indeed out of position. Two more, but this time there's a good reaction though by Pili. Only two probes fall. Todd, one overlord on the top side of the base. Why wouldn't he try to morph it into a dropper lord? He has so many links. Just give it one shot.
I think Elazer is worried he's going to be attacked into and not have enough. So he keeps all his units on the ground on his side of the map.
Wow,
I mean, there is a ton of sentries here. Force fields are going to be key. And I don't think there are dropper lords available here to drop on top of this, which would be the big weakness.
Oh my god, those force fields are super clutch. A couple of twins will get picked off as well. There are a few ravages to break the force fields, but the bailing count right now is simply not high enough. Elazer is counterattacking, but he has to worry about defending his army. Maybe if he could get a snipe on the war prism, that would be massive. But Todd, this is a very, very awkward situation for Elazer, and his tournament life is on the line.
He's still not morphing any overlords here. He's PiLiPiLi. He's going to drop a lot of these units here in between the force fields and dealing a ton of damage here to this army, getting rid of most of it already. Supply-wise, he's taking the lead.
And this is no bailing speed either, so it's going to be really hard for Banes to get the connections that they're looking for.
Ooh, there's not many force fields left, and this army is very clumped up. If Banes can connect, that's nice, actually, to buy time like this by Elazer.
Yeah, but he needs more time, and he's getting a couple of additional roaches. He's morphing a few more Banes. These Banes get some connections, but really not the connections they're looking for. That's kind of nice, on top of the sentries and a few of the adepts. But the Zerg army thought is so incredibly small. I think Pili is doing it.
Wow. Looks like he might be able to crush through this army here back at home from Elazer. North America, Roddy.
Oh my god.
The return.
Pili. What a performance by this young man, living in San Diego, representing Sidestorm Gaming. Hailing from Kazakhstan, he's playing out of his mind this tournament, Todd. Who could have ever thought that PiLiPiLi was going to make it out of this bracket? I mean, it's not over yet. Elazer is doing his absolute best to hang in there. And slowly but steady, a few units do die. But PiLi just has too much.
I remember you were one of the first guys to actually hype this player. We're back when we were hosting show matches. You were like, I want him to be part of this show match. He's actually a pretty good up-and-coming NA player. Look at him. He can't believe it. Yeah. I don't think he was particularly that confident going into these matches. Like, he probably knew that he could do it, but going up against somebody as strong as Elazer, who's had such a strong year last year in his homeland, and now he's able to do it and move on to the group stage. This is huge here, the best performance of his life here.
Absolutely.
By far.
I couldn't agree more. What a run through a very tough bracket. I love it as well. Look at the emotions, the fist pumps. The dark PiLiPiLi has done it, Todd. Secured himself over $1,000, but obviously just making it out of a bracket like this is so much more important. Getting big wins over Sordo, big wins over Daishi, and now the decider. I mean, it's a devastating loss for Elazer, and I feel for him, but at the same time, it's hard not to be happy for PiLi. Yeah. What a run.
He was outplayed for sure here. It was Elazer. Like, he showed some good things, but PiLiPiLi just slightly better, and that was the important match here that he couldn't afford to lose. So we're going to head to a break, and then when we come back, we'll hear from the man himself, PiLiPiLi.